having long ago become comfortable with her utopian society, Winter is surprised to learn that there are other worlds in other planes of existence. These worlds are quite different from hers, ranging from troubled to dystopian to futuristic or fantastical. However, they are all riddled with problems that, if not resolved, may adversely affect her home world. She has chosen to become a mediator, charged with the maintenance of order in these chaotic planes, and so enters a vocational school for training. Episode 1 details her second shadowing of a seasoned mediator, only a few weeks into her first year. She and her mentor enter a world seemingly much like their own, except for this issue of poverty with which Winter has difficulty understanding. Okay, that is the synopsis, everyone. Hello, welcome to Dysfunctional Systems Episode 1, Learning to Manage Chaos. So this is an episodic visual novel made by Dischan, who are the same people that made Juniper's Knot. And it's the major difference between this and Juniper's, or at least a major difference between the format of this and Juniper's Knot, is that Juniper's Knot was a kinetic novel, meaning you didn't have any influence over the story. It was a visual novel in the most literal sense of the term. However, in this one, in Dysfunctional Systems, you actually do have influence over the story. So it's quite a bit different in that way. Alright, yeah, so after playing Juniper's Knot, and really, really liking it, being incredibly impressed with it, I took a look at what the people behind it, Dischan, what else they have done. And I found this, and it looks freaking amazing. I was blown away just by how it looks. I don't know how it's actually going to be playing it, you know, we'll have to see, but it looks amazing. It's making some really good first impressions. I mean, just look at the art. Look at the art quality of this. Just look at that. That is amazing. That is seriously some of the best art I've ever seen in my life. And just look at the way this menu's set up. Not only is the background art good, but look at how everything's moving. Things are spinning, things are moving back and forth. If you open the settings menu, look at the way it comes in. It's so polished. And the music, just the music in the menu is awesome. It's making some really good first impressions. So yeah, let's get into it. New story. It just sounds so interesting. From the television. Working families across Brighton are no doubt issuing a collective sigh of relief today as the legislation for a minimum wage increase of 50 cents passed in Parliament early this morning. This bill comes after public outcry that the majority of Brighton citizens are without enough income, too poor to make ends meet after the recent increase in food prices. The change brings minimum wage for workers working over 40 hours a week to $3.67 an hour, and workers working less to $3.20. Wait a minute, $3.67 an hour? What? That doesn't sound good. Although welcomed by most, there's been stiff opposition towards the bill from foreign investors, primarily those from Gabria. Major Gabrian companies, such as I don't know how to pronounce those, Ujco and Norkley, have warned that wage increases would hurt Brighton's economy, arguing that the new rate would force more layoffs as they cannot afford as many employees. President Barnaby, who has been supportive of the legislation since its inception, retorted that well-fed employees were more productive and reminded Ujco and Norkley representatives that employing a Brighton citizen was still over 16 times less expensive than employing a citizen of their home country. Stocks did, however, take a moderate tumble after the approval of the legislation. President Barnaby assured citizens that the drop should only be temporary and that the markets will begin to rise again after the initial shock has subsided. With this minimum wage increase, Barnaby has finally fulfilled the last of the campaign promises made during his 15-23 campaign trail. Whether or not he manages to accomplish his 15-27 goals remains to be seen. With that, we conclude our hourly business report. Next up, the latest in entertainment news. Okay, so I'm guessing this is from the plane of existence where the economy is doing poorly. Yeah, because that sounds horrible. That sounds wretched. Without a doubt, I still find it strange. Everything strange, bizarre. Really, if these worlds were nothing like my own, at least then I could appropriately flip out. But no, they're similar. Too similar. I keep slipping into a feeling of normalcy, only to have that sensation of strangeness slap me across the face at the first sight of something weird. There are plenty of weird sights around to do so, too. Like, for instance, these advanced-looking televisions in this decrepit-looking building, which I can only assume is an electronic store. They're the first thing I've seen since arriving in this world that actually looks somewhat new. Fancy, even. Up until now, everything has been old, ramshackle, and in various states of disrepair. It makes me feel very nervous. It's just so profoundly disturbing. Will I ever get used to this? I think that I will, some year or decade from now, if my mentor is any indication. Look at him, standing there so aloof, as if this were just another day to him, which, yeah, I suppose it is. Well, what do I know? Nothing. Winter? Yes? What do you think? Think? About what? About what we just saw and heard. Oh. To be honest, I wasn't really thinking anything about it. Winter? We've only just started. Please try to focus. Yeah, I will. Sorry. It's just, well, I'm still finding it a bit hard to wrap my head around the idea of destructive conflict. Well, of course, I was the same when I first started out. There aren't that many examples of conflict at all in our world. Right. You might even find it surprising that war is actually a word in our dictionary. Totally. Yet still, Winter, you'll come to understand conflict very well. Don't worry. After all, you'll be doing nothing but dealing with it. Lame. Well, anyway. You read the material on this world, right? It should have been your homework. It was. Then tell me what you think. Perhaps it's time to admit that I didn't spend much of last night reading the material so much as turning the pages and glancing at them. I was tired and honestly found watching the bubbles in my soda significantly more captivating than the words in those files. The way they merge with each other and crawl up the glass is really incredibly pretty. You were certainly pondering rather hard there, Winter. You must be whipping up a dazzling answer. Brighton is poor? That's a fact, Winter, not a thought. What I think is... I think... Nothing. Look, what I've learned so far in class doesn't seem to be particularly applicable to this world, so I'm finding it a bit difficult to care. How can I care anyway? Besides all that, this is all so disconnected from me. Plus, it's only my second world, for heaven's sake. I'm still flummoxed by the fact that other worlds exist. What am I supposed to think when they just toss me into these places, give me a pat on the back, and say, "Be on your way, merry child"? Actually, here's a thought. What kind of a name is Brighton? That's a stupid name for a country. It sounds more like a town. The town of Brighton, population 40. Ugh, ugh. I'll scream blah at Cyrus and any other mentor who questions me like this. I mean, I won't, but I would. I completely, totally, and so would. For now, though, an awkward and wobbling smile is all I can muster. Bleh. Well, whatever. What do you think the next step is? Alright, cool it, Winter. Just remain calm and genuinely consider the question. Wait. Hold on. Was that an intentional or unintentional pun? Cool it, Winter? Seriously? Her name's Winter? Cool it, Winter? Are you kidding me? Hmm. The next thing to do, we need to learn things that weren't given. Right. Sir, I couldn't ask my last mentor. Why are the dossiers we get before we come to these places so thin? Well, it's because they're simply comprised of first-hand information. Noteworthy things that mediators have gathered through observation and gleaned from prior trips to the world. You're lucky you even have that much. Sometimes you get sent to worlds that have never been visited before. Let me tell you, it's never fun when a surprise dragon flies out from behind a mountain. Or when you realize that the person you've been talking to is really just a convincing projection. Or worse, a robot. And once you start going into systems that threaten your definition of what being a world even means, good luck. Then again, only experienced mediators have to deal with such things. You won't be going to any unvisited worlds, at least definitely not yet. Hmm. Oh. Another question. Why revisit worlds that have been helped? I mean, once order is in place, everything should be fine, right? I mean... Cyrus frowns, but his expression seems more complicated than that. I say that because his frown isn't alone. In his eyes, there's a glint of irritation, directed at no one in particular. As any glint, it's gone in a second, replaced by another thing that I can't quite decipher. Part of me is curious as to what it is, but most of me doesn't care. Here's the short answer. Because chaos cannot be contained or removed. Although it can be lessened by us, it will rise again over time. Sir, are you saying there's no point to anything? No. Chaos is not inherently bad, Winter. It is the means by which all worlds are born and continue, even ours. Furthermore, it is the spark of evolution. It plays a key part in those mutations which allow life to grow and improve itself. However, for life to succeed, there must also be order. It's like, Well, it's like how cells must work together and organs must serve their purpose. You see, a system where chaos is stronger than order is likely to collapse, just as an organism which has succumbed to disease is likely to die. In short, we are not here to eradicate chaos, Winter. We are only here to keep it in check. Oh. Anyway, where do you think we should go next? Well, someplace with a lot of information, I suppose. Allow me to get to thinking about such a place. Oh, surprise, I'm done. The answer is so obvious, it's insulting. After all, I had already gone there during my first mediation. The library. No, that's not... Why would we go to the library? I mean, I get your line of thought. Libraries can tell you a lot about a world's history. And I would bet there are computers there too, considering the world we're in. Unfortunately, that kind of knowledge probably wouldn't be so helpful for this job. What about scholarly journals? Reliable sources? No. I think we should find a bar. Huh? What is it? Oh, well, I just had a thought. Are the bars here special, like library bars? I figured maybe you like to drink as you read, maybe. Winter, stop thinking about libraries. Sorry. I'd also just like to point out that his eyes seem like infinitely bored. Those are the eyes of an infinitely bored person who could not be more bored. He just looks like he doesn't care about anything. Look at how bored he looks. Just like a straight, flat mouth and just bored eyes. It's like he doesn't care about anything. He looks dead inside. Bars here should be normal, as far as I'm aware. We'll head there because bars are where people go to talk. Cyrus then turns to walk away, as if it is the next natural thing to do. Well, it is not. I stand incredulously for 3 full seconds before realizing that we are supposed to move ahead. Did I say incredulously? I think it's incredulously. Right? Incredulous? I don't know. I think it's incredulously. Incredulously. I don't know. Close enough. Whatever. Well, here we are. Walking along. Is this a street? I've seen a few vehicles pass us by, so I guess it is. Or I should say that I've heard them, for they have been loud. They're pretty sorry excuses for transportation, though. They have these grotesque metal protrusions out of their fronts, which billow dark smoke and occasionally drip liquid. As if that weren't bad enough, most every frame of these things has looked like a bludgeon team went wild on it. They were such bewildering things that they distracted me from the matter at hand. Cyrus. Is he not going to elaborate at all? He just walked off after telling me that people talk at bars. Thanks, Cyrus. I would not have guessed that people talk at places. Isn't he supposed to be teaching me? How can I learn anything with such vague statements? Well, Winter, well, well, you need to go to the ice cream parlor, Winter. Wow, I totally mispronounced that. Let me try that again. Well, Winter, well, well, you need to go to the ice cream parlor, Winter, because they sell food, Winter, well. Goodness, how annoying. And hasn't he been annoying since orientation? Pestering me and staring at me and annoying an unlikable person, this Cyrus? With your reputation at that, I hear. I mean, seriously, don't people talk everywhere? Sir, don't people talk everywhere? Isn't that the sort of things humans are known for in general? Well, aren't you snippy? Oh crap, I just ruined everything, didn't I? I need to stop thinking so much, or I'll let my thoughts slip out. Yeah, I shouldn't have said it like that. He's my superior. I bet he'll lower my grade now. Sorry, sir, I didn't mean to be. It's just a bit frustrating when you don't explain yourself properly. Oh, I thought it was mostly self-explanatory. Not really at all, sir. Well, maybe it is, but I don't really know anything about bars. I've never even seen the outside of one. Ah, that's right. We're really not into drinking back home, are we? I don't know if I would say that. Perhaps not everyone is the same. Well, bars are generally a place where people go to unwind. And the alcohol loosens their lips, so to speak. They'll talk about almost anything. Themselves, their troubles. And often, the root of the problem will involve what is troubling the world's people. It's a useful place to visit. Speaking of problems, what was the issue of the last world you visited? Pollution. The world was kind of oldish and much less practical than ours. They kept throwing out their stuff wrong, and had bad ways of making energy. Their water ended up getting poisoned, and a lot of them were sick. Long-term project, I assume? Yeah, my mentor had already been working on it for a while before I came. I think it was around 5 months. Alright, before I continue, I will be right back. Okay, let's continue. That's so. I'm glad I'm assigned short-term projects. It'd be something awful to get stuck with the same problem for nearly a year. I agree, but I don't know about the way you've said it. I don't know about the way you said that. How long did you shadow her? 3 days. I see. You've never had alcohol, have you? What was that? I guess she has. What? No, sir, I would never. I mean, I'm too young. I stop in my tracks, and he stops to turn. His lips then curl up in a kind of oh-ho-ho expression, oh-ho-hoing at my innocence, ripe to be defiled. It is creepy. I am uncomfortable.
That is a very creepy look on his face. What the hell? Ugh.
But how old is she? She looks quite young. No, you wouldn't do anything against the rules, would you? Is that a test? A trick? A challenge? No, sir, I would not. His smile broadens at this, and my discomfort increases. You know, Winter, each world you visit will have its own law, its own laws, its own customs, and its own social graces. You're going to have to learn to make your mind a little more flexible if you want to succeed. I'm going to have you drink some alcohol at the bar.
Excuse me?
I don't want to. Besides, I'm underage. It's against the law. Well, Winter, in many cultures you'll be expected to drink, even at your current age. You should be ready for that, and you should know the effects alcohol has on yourself and others.
What?
He's telling me to break the law? Whoa, no, that is completely out of my comfort zone. I probably hate alcohol even, right? I do not want to do this. I mean, I know we're in another world, so it's not really the law, but... No, this is my conviction. I was born and raised to a set of rules, and I think it would be best to live by them. It is like what I learned in class. One might think it best to try absorbing all aspects of cultures met. However, it is not advisable. In absorbing a culture, you run the risk of becoming absorbed by that culture as well. Mediators should not forget who they are. I am Winter Harrison. I will not be shaken by this. I don't think I can do that, sir. Winter? That's an order. This is part of your training. If you do not drink alcohol at the bar, I will be forced to fail you.
You fucking kidding me?
Cyrus, you are a creepy douchebag.
What?
That isn't... Hmm? That's not allowed. You can't make me do anything. I most certainly can. I'm your mentor. Only for today. Only for today, and you aren't always going to be that. Besides, you can't threaten me because I have my convictions, and I won't forget who I am. I'm right. I can tell I'm right because my cheeks are flushed, and my heart is pounding and he looks wounded. I hurt him. I shrug out against him. And he knows he's wrong. It isn't just enough that he's hurting inside, though. I need to teach him a lesson. I need to knock it into him. Therefore, I will raise this trembling arm and trembling fist. I will raise it and grit my teeth and I'll punch him right in his pathetic-looking chest.
Ha!
What?
What the hell? Nice attempt, Winter?
Winter, what is this? I'm rebelling against you. Did you just punch me? I nod my head quickly and with purpose. You did. What does it look like? My fist smashed into your ribs, didn't it? Well, smashed is... All of a sudden, my hair goes poof, as if something heavy has lightly fallen on it. I glance up to find Cyrus resting his hand on my head. This is just... This is just too cute. Although I know what he is doing, in fact, I just said so, I still am compelled to ask. What are you doing? Winter, fine, I won't force you to drink. You mean you can't? I mean I won't. I will, however, put forth a stern suggestion. It would be very wise of you to drink. It will help you ease into the taste of another place.
I know what they've taught you, and I'd be lying if I said I ignore what I've learned. Just remember the way it's worded. You're allowed to let yourself go a little, just don't forget. I haven't forgotten. And neither have you, it seems. But you shouldn't be afraid of stepping outside of yourself, if only for a little while. In a sense, that's what you're doing already in being here. So I urge you, Winter. Have a pint. I'll... Just a little. Good enough. Well, there's a bar. Come on, Winter. That's a bar. What makes it any different from the other stores? It looks just the same from outside. They don't seem to pride themselves on distinction out here. I run my hand through my hair and grimace. I wonder if since all the storefronts look like this, maybe they're all bars? What a terrible thought. What if this is a culture which loves to drink? Will I be expected to drink a lot? I hope not. Warily, I begin to follow Cyrus. What am I doing? This is so illegal. I wonder if I can report this. Okay, brace for it. No amount of alcohol-tinged breath could be enough to prepare me for a bar smell, surely. Mother always talks about how awful bars are, and how that's why she only ever drinks at home. Sweaty and piggish and smelling like failure. And this can only lead to misery. Before I continue, I'd just like to point out that there appears to be a slender man in the background.
He has no face. Why does he have no face? That's really creepy.
Slowly, I part the fingers over my nostrils. It does not smell at all. Cut that out, Winter. You look ridiculous. Hey, leave me alone. I've been misled. Slowly, I put down my hand, but not without glaring at Cyrus. He ignores this, of course, and walks over to an empty table to have a seat. He then pats the top of the chair next to him, inviting me. Well, whatever. I follow his lead, still cautious of this place. Notice how there's only a few people here, although it's lunch hour? What do you imagine that means? Most of the people here really like to work? Or maybe they really have to. Well, it's probably a good thing that this place is so empty. Too many customers might be a bit overwhelming for you. Can also make it rather difficult to actually find out anything. I see. There are only four other people in the bar besides us, all of whom are men, and all thrice my age by the look of it. The two who seem to be customers are dressed in a rather rough manner, like they've walked out of a construction site. I'm not the type to pride myself on appearance or anything, but I actually feel slightly embarrassed for them. They aren't the first in this world to look so deplorable, though. In fact, I would say they look fairly good by comparison. Most people I've seen look like they picked their outfits from a pile of rags. Thankfully, the other two, both in uniform, are very presentable. The waiter, or he's probably the waiter, looks rather spiffy, and the man behind the counter is quite cleanly dressed, so this world is not entirely hopeless. But enough about men in clothes, the wall behind the counter is far more interesting. There are two lengthy rows of wildly varying bottles, some round, some square, and some outright peculiar. Admittedly, I am enticed. Only for a second, I assure you. After all. I've been told that alcohol tastes like piss. Well, I wouldn't know myself. I've never tried it. What? You've never tried alcohol? It's funny, I'm reading her dialogue and that's exactly what I was thinking. So I was saying my own thoughts and reading her dialogue at the same time. What? Oh god, look at that epic frown on his face. That is one hell of a frown. No, piss. Oh. Never mind. It isn't the best until you get used to it. And that aside, I've also been told that it makes you act like a twit, causes bouts of forgetfulness, and slowly poisons your liver. That is true, to a point. Eventually, you become addicted to it. Not everyone does, but there's the possibility. Then why drink it? Some people enjoy losing control over themselves, and many love to forget. You'll see for yourself, and be able to form your own opinion soon. I would rather not. Honestly, I am more than fine with following the popular opinion. It is often correct and has saved me a lot of trouble in the past. While my thoughts wander to safer days, the man who I believe is a waiter comes to our table. What can I get you? 2 beers, any brand you like? Any brand you'd like? Coming right up. When he departs, I find myself curious about 2 things. Firstly, I have to drink 2 beers? No, 1 is for me. Why would you want to drink one? I am one of the people who enjoy losing a bit of control over themselves. I would not have pegged him the sort. At any rate, the second thing. What's a brand, sir? Does it have something to do with fire and iron? Pardon? Well, we used to brand cattle and other animals with a symbol that would associate them with their farmer, right? That is, if I remember my history. That was with fire and iron, so this is something similar. I'm not saying something stupid, am I? Is it how the alcohol is made, perhaps? Are the ingredients burned in some way before they're officially beer? Maybe with some sort of spiritual symbol? They do call them spirits, after all. There must be a reason for that, right? He's back to frowning. Why isn't he saying anything? Or it has something to do with real spirits? Like some sort of rite where each batch is brewed in honor of someone who's died? I mean, I've heard these places can be very strange, and am I close? Oh, please let me be close. No. No, you are not close. Crap. I should have shut up way earlier. Why did I ramble like that? Now I look the fool. Honestly, though, I'm a little disappointed. Some fantasy would be nice. Winter, I'm starting to think you've already gotten yourself drunk off the atmosphere. Oh, please. Here you go. The waiter has returned, bearing 2 tall and thick tankards foaming at the brim. Beer, right? I know more of vodka and wines. One is placed in front of Cyrus, and the other in front of me. Enjoy. He leaves. I peek over my cup's lip and peer into its mouth. The beverage does not take kindly to my curiosity, bubbling and spitting at me. I withdraw with a start. How intimidating. Sir, don't be such a baby. It won't kill you. There'll be much worse things you'll have to swallow than alcohol, trust me. It sounds as though Cyrus is perfectly fine with bending over, should the situation demand it. Ingesting things like this, ingesting things worse than this. Allow me to apologize, Cyrus, but I am not a wimp. I know where to draw the line. It is quite the opposite of weakness, really, it's strength. No one is going to be forcing me to do anything I don't agree to. That said, I did say I would drink some of this. Lifting the glass with both hands, I gingerly tip it towards my lip, and take in a mouthful. Ugh. Oh heavens, I do not want to drink this. I swish the liquid a bit, and as it mixes with my saliva, it seems nearly viscous even. I want to retch. This is simply the worst thing I've ever put in my mouth. Atrocious. It bullies the back of my throat with a sizzling, no, a burning sensation that has spread throughout my entire oral cavity. The ordeal lasts less than 10 seconds before I stop thinking and just swallow it. Oh, come on. Goosebumps ripple across my skin, and my eyes water.
The beer drains down my esophagus, raising everything in its descent. This is disgusting. Cyrus proceeds to drain half of his glass, with a speed rivaling my mother's, and an expression just as insensible. It amazes me that he can stomach it, and even more that he is willingly subjecting himself to it. This is pretty okay, actually. Best I've had in a while. You're joking. That was worse than what I imagined piss to taste like. And the sensation. Everything about it is just, it's disgusting. Honestly, I find myself at a loss for words here. This beverage is just nasty. Finish that glass, and we'll move along. I'm not finishing this. Do it. Do it. I mock him. Don't take that tone. Just finish your glass. Finish my glass. I let my hands drop with gravity, my cup crashing onto the table. This is what you want me to finish? Then, Cyrus, who I'm quickly losing respect for, I will drink this mug and in fact finish it if you do one thing for me in the future. Pardon? It isn't loud in here, Cyrus. I know that you heard me. Well then, what do you want me to do? Nothing now. The future is not now. Now is the present. The future is later, and I will tell you then. You sure you're not drunk, Winter? Hush. Fine. You'll have your way if you'll have mine, Winter Harrison. It is a deal you cannot break, sir. With that, I drain my glass in a matter of seconds, using a technique I've observed over the years. When I set it down, there is naught but suds. Cyrus is impressed. I am appalled. This is so nasty. I squeeze my eyes shut and let the wave of warm and trembling feelings wash over me. Ugh. Mercy, Winter. That was something else. How are you feeling? I answer him with a stare and a shiver. Really? I shake my head. Honestly, now that the wretched experience of an instant is over, I realize I was overreacting. While certainly vile, it doesn't seem to be immediately damaging. It looks like it will take more than one beer to impair my judgment. Either that, or the stuff's effects are simply delayed. I'm fine, I think. Ah. You should be. Yes, I don't really... I realize I might have spoken too soon, and I suddenly feel a bit... as though I'm glowing? It's not a terrible feeling, and I seem to still be myself. All is in order. I don't feel much different at all. Give it some time. You didn't really drink too much anyway. There usually isn't a whole lot of alcohol in beer. Wonderful. Both of my theories are true. Okay, so what now? Now, we begin conversing. Cyrus discreetly points to a man in the corner. I'm going to talk to that man. You take the one at the counter. Try bringing up work and going on from there. Oh, and of course, don't forget to keep where you're from and why we're here a secret. That kind of bartering... Chips shouldn't even be allowed to you kids. I'm going to talk to him alone? Well, yes, I think it would make him pretty uncomfortable to have both of us ganging up on him. Oh, I don't know about this. Don't worry, the bartender is right there and I'm not far either. Nothing will happen to you. It's not that. I'm just not very good at talking to people. You're doing fine with me. You're my superior. Just go over there and give it a try. Fine. Hello, Slenderman. Let's go talk to the Slenderman.
I get out of my seat and immediately yank at the table's edge as the floor shifts. Uh-oh. Ugh, no. My knees quiver with fear, and I firmly plant my feet, my heart thumping like I'm about to die. Gracious, what was that? Did something happen? Have we failed? Calm down. You're just a bit tipsy. Shut up. I pause. Tipsy. Oh, buzzed. Right, I'm just... Ugh, crap. Just get over there. I surprise myself, briskly taking strides to the counter. I find the act curiously challenging and amusing. Each step I consider rather silly in its shakiness, and I begin wondering about how people learn to walk at all. It is not how my thoughts usually go, I think. I can't quite remember what I usually think about right now. I'm not drunk. I have an idea of what that is from looking, and this is not it. Ah, right, I am tipsy. Goodness, I'm unbalanced. I start slowing near the stools and suddenly break out in a cold sweat. I'm not good with people. So what am I doing about to talk to a man? While I'm considering this, the order to stop is not processed physically. I sit right down next to the gentleman as if it is the most natural thing in the world, and we are the oldest of pals, strong ties, bonds formed from years of manual labor at the piers. I wonder how much alcohol I actually drank. Enough of this. Engage the man by his eyes. Yes, like that, in the books. Well, I'd like to point out that because he's a slender man, he doesn't have eyes, so good luck with that. Also, you might die if you look at him. Okay, he does have eyes. Lean forward and get a closer look, Winter Harrison. Huh. Well, isn't he scruffy? Almost in an adorable way, his cheeks and chin are dashed all over with stubble, and his eyes are soft and caring. He vaguely reminds me of a father I knew that was not mine, but a classmate's. I open my mouth and mentally say hello, but the order is again not actually processed, so I just hang my jaw and stare. I'm just imagining her just with her mouth open, just staring at him. So weird. He notices. Hello there, miss. Hello. It is all I can do to say this. I fail to keep his attention, and his eyes return to the television above the bar. Television. That's right. They have that here. It seems to be a sports channel that he is watching. Not that I know which. I only know it is sport as there is a ball, there are people, and both are on a field. Ah, and it seems to involve only sculpted men. A particularly intimate sport. Wait, I'm overthinking it. Though I do believe that most sports have a peculiar and exciting kind of subtext, this one I think I could particularly like to watch. You're a little young to be in here, aren't you? Yes, I am. I am 14, I should not be here. Okay, she's 14, oh my god. I'm here with my uncle. My dad would never bring me here. My uncle is here and brought me here while he's on break. Right. Mention work. Where is he? I point to Cyrus, who is now talking amiably with the other man in the corner. Goodness, such fast friends. He is the younger, ornery-looking person. The old man chuckles, and I smile as though I've made a joke. Interesting word choice, girl. I read books. That's so. It is so. Very much so. I read a lot. Is he celebrating the good news? Maybe. Was there some news? Do you mean the minimum wage increase, sir? Yeah, great news, isn't it? He grins. I mirror him. It is. I'm glad. You working yet? Yes, it is work that I'm doing. Granted, unpaid. I'm learning.
Yes, I just started a little while ago. I see. Well, welcome to the workforce, young miss. Have you gotten your first paycheck yet? No, not yet. And my name is Winter. That should have been two sentences. Nice to meet you, Winter. I'm David. I've stopped speaking. I don't know why. It's almost as though anything I say won't make any sense, so I've shut up. He does not speak either. The quietness is getting to me. Isn't there something I can say? Anything? What can I say? No, I'm lost. This is a terrible feeling, like I'm drowning in air. Think. There must be something. What? You okay? Huh? Oh no, I'm panicking. He could tell. That's bad. Is this because of the alcohol? It must be the alcohol. Yeah. Speak. What do you do?
Seriously? Winter's asking the bartender what he does? Winter, I'm pretty sure I know what he does. Like, for work, I mean.
You know, help out at the... Is that pronounced wharf? I think it's pronounced wharf. Head down into the mines, fit auto parts. Oh, okay, never mind. He actually has many jobs. It sounds like the economy's so screwed that everyone just works odd jobs and just basically takes whatever they can.
That is amazing.
Amazing. No. When you get older, you'll have to run multiple jobs, too. Just about the only way to survive these days. How about you? What do you do?
Oh crap, what do I do? Why didn't I think of something first? Stupid.
I shut my eyes for a second and give a quick shake of my head. What I do? Well, I guess I could technically be considered a... I'm a... consoler. I'm hoping that's pronounced consoler. Consoler? A consoler? I mean, consoler. I just forgot how I pronounced it. Whoops. Yes. Huh. Please let that be an acceptable job. Doesn't really seem like something that suits you. No offense or anything. I didn't really choose it. He gives me a somber nod of recognition. Yeah, you gotta take what you're given. Yes. I suddenly feel miserable, and decide to lean onto the counter. I rest my head, letting the fluff of my hair and sleeves serve as a pillow, and I look away from David. That's right, I didn't really choose it. I didn't really choose anything. As decisions came around, I just sat on my hands thinking. I don't know, thinking that something would come to me. In a sense, I suppose that something did, but it wasn't in the usual way. Everyone else knew what they wanted to do after secondary school, and I was stuck on the path of a freeder. A freeder. A step away from a leech. Ugh. I couldn't pick a specialty school. I didn't know what I wanted. School mediatorum, huh? What is this school? Why had I never heard of it, yet somehow my parents weren't surprised by the name? Why was I chosen? What's more, how? I never applied to this thing. Why did I even accept to go? I guess I was just happy that something had been found for me. And the system always knows best. I mean, it's not as though I dislike it. I find the classwork and homework more than bearable. And my first shadowing went okay enough. But is this what I am? Is this what I'm meant to do? Oh, this is stupid. What am I thinking? The oligarchy is infallible. They never make mistakes. Therefore, this must be what's right for me. Okay, hold on. I don't remember what oligarchy means. Let's find out, shall we? Define oligarchy. Did I spell that correctly? No, I did not. It does not have two L's. A small group of people having control of a country, organization, or institution. Okay. It's a form of power structure in which power effectively rests with a small number of people. Okay, got it. Even if everything about it is totally weird. Wait, what the hell is that? Cuckold? What? What's my issue? This is better than what would have happened. When did I start caring so much about my direction? Wait, what am I thinking? I'm supposed to care about that. Still, why should I? How should I know the way to forge my life's path when I'm just 14? I don't even know what I'll be like in 8 years. I shouldn't have to care about this now. No, this is really messed up. I'm so messed up. Hey, don't get like that. I'm sorry I brought it up. Can I get you something to drink? I turn back to glance at David, my nose tip brushing against cloth and sending a tingle across my face. Seeing him, I remember again. I'm in another world. As if I didn't have enough worries back home. Now I have a whole new world to worry about here. Another world which I had never heard of, but I'm supposed to believe is real? Just because things are right here in front of my eyes? So much strange stuff has happened to me that maybe I could just be dreaming. Is this man even real? Is he really there? Maybe he isn't. I've read that there are illusions. Would I prefer an illusion? Would I prefer this to be a dream? Maybe some sort of virtual reality? This whole idea is so ridiculous. What's worst of all? I find myself rather on the fence about his offer for a second drink. It would not be bad, actually. To forget who I am for a little while, perhaps longer. It would be natural. No, it would also be dangerous. I force the darker notions aside, steady the course. I draw my head back into the nest of my arms, hair curling over fingers. And I bring myself up, countenance solemn. No, I think I've had enough. Suit yourself. I will. I look at David. Alright, what's next again? Need to figure out the root of the problem. It usually has something to do with the troubles of the people, right? I'll just be forward then. Has anything been troubling you lately? Nothing more than usual, I suppose. I'm just here to commemorate the occasion. That wage hike takes a major load off, though. It's really too bad that we're still under Gabriel's boot. You know, I bet they let the bill pass just to avoid revolt. They don't give a shit about us. Gabria, that's not this country, is it? Wasn't that the mother country, correct? I think that Brighton shouldn't be a colony of theirs anymore. It was labeled as independent in the dossier. I need to know more. How might I ask properly? What about the president? He seems to be working for us? He does, right? You know it doesn't matter. He's just a figurehead. He can't do anything without Gabriel's approval. Couldn't even raise a military to defend against... Ferdia? I'm gonna go with Ferdia. Without them kicking up a fuss. Hell, it took 6 months before they let him train a single soldier. I'll give them some credit, though. They quit crying about it, and have been funding us rightly ever since. Probably realize that if Fedria took us over, then they'd lose their workhorse. Fedria is... a third country sharing a border with Brighton. Okay. This is really cool. Going over her memories of this new world that she's in. And the fact that you actually get to see it is really cool. It really gives me a sense of where this place is. Just in the most literal sense, physically where it is. Oh, whoa, crap. What did I just press? I just pressed the codex. Which actually reminds me I should probably save it. Because I've never done that. And of course, this game even has an extremely cool looking save system.
which is not surprising at all. What was it I read about them last night? Don't we have a truce with them or something? It has been around for a while. Yeah, but it's hardly there. Fedra has never been too afraid to stir up a war or two over some real estate. Or over some insult to their forefathers, whatever excuse. Our truce with them is just a piece of paper. If they wanted to, they'd take us down in a heartbeat. Or they would have, at least, until we got an army to secure the border. Never know, though. Wow, this guy talks a lot. It's wonderful. I hardly have to say a word. Or at least, I would if he didn't seem to want me to respond now. I put on a bit of an angry expression for a second, but then reconsider it. Maybe a sad expression would be better? What's my character anyway? Am I being myself here? Wait, no. None of that matters. Just answer. That's terrible. Okay, I need another question. Maybe I should let some of my ignorance show. Why is it like this anyway? You don't know? Hell, I'm not surprised. They practically skip over that in schools, and give it a paragraph, maybe. Sure, they'll tell you Brighton used to be a Gabrian colony, that we gained our independence 120 years ago. They just never mention the costs of that freedom. Economic sanctions, crazy ones. I mean, they weren't always crazy. Back then, minimum wage could feed you and more. The sanctions haven't changed, though. Haven't adjusted with the dollar value and cost of living. We screwed up. Got lulled into this false sense of liberty. Got so caught up in the things we could do, we forgot what we can't. Thanks to inflation, these sanctions are making us so poor that they're killing us. I mean, literally killing us. Not a great thing to bring up when there's something to celebrate, but I don't think they're tracking just how many have died trying to live. I know I've definitely lost count. This, then, is this the root? I mean, it sure does suck that these people are poor. Really? Though honestly, if they've been this way for so long, they should be used to it. What is poor exactly? The television was harping on it earlier, and David was harping on it just now. So I figure it must be important, but, you know, it's nonsense we've considered this seriously. I don't understand any of this. The obsession over the economy, the excitement over higher wages. None of it makes sense. Poor is not having enough for a snack. Money is a trivial thing. Another thing is that this is not even a major society of the world. That being the case, how come we're dealing with it at all? And Cyrus, what is he thinking in dragging me here? He probably only wanted a drink. What can I learn about the whole world from just one person? Not much. Ugh, this is stupid. Stupid. Ugh, it must be something else. If it's so terrible here, I wonder how it is in Gabria. Complete luxury. They live like kings. Even their bums live better than us. Whoa, that is filthy. A filthy thing to say. It's a damn miracle any of them work at all with how much they get for free. They get fired. The state takes care of it. They're hurt. The state covers it. No job to start with. The state. The state will go to the goddamn moons for its precious Gabrians. Can you believe it? People are starving here and it's that kind of fucking bullshit that... I wince and raise my shoulders a little. Oh. Sorry. It's okay. I don't really take any offense to swear words or rude language, but my dad was never terribly fond of them, and I've grown unused to their bite. The harsher ones, anyway. It's a bit shocking to hear one in that tone. I decide to look back at the television, feeling embarrassed on David's behalf for reasons beyond my immediate comprehension. It airs the same sport for all of 4 seconds before cutting out. When the picture returns, a twisty and intricate crest, a duck flying over sword and pickaxe, looks like, appears on the screen, set against a noble sky. Uh-oh, this does not sound good. What's about to happen? Could this be a team logo? An address to the audience from the coach and captain? Ooh, I want to see. I lean back a few feet from the counter until I'm supporting myself only slightly with my fingers and mostly with the stool's two hind legs. Honestly, the warmth of the beer has not completely dissipated. David, what is that? Holy... Yeah, this sounds like a revolt or a terrorist attack or something. George, turn it up. The person who is wiping glasses behind the counter raises his eyebrows slightly, and then reaches listlessly for the remote. When it is in his hands, he turns and gives the television a tired glance. The crest on the screen wakes his eyes immediately, and he is soon mashing the volume up. I hear David, shifting at my right, and it sounds as though he's turning in the direction of Cyrus and the other man. Clark, get over here. Oh, so that is the man's name, Clark. Clark and Cyrus look at David strangely, and then strangely look at one another, and then they begin rushing over. I find their antics confusing and unwarranted. What is the big deal over this? In a few moments, the whole gaggle of men surrounds the television. Even the waiter has stopped cleaning tables to watch. I know that sports are popular and all, but this is a little bit much, isn't it? This is an emergency broadcast system. This is not a test. Please pay close attention to the following message. Oh. The message will begin in 40 seconds. This is the emergency broadcast system. This is not a test. Please pay close attention to the following message. The message will begin in 30 seconds. Goodness, this is it, isn't it? It. The thing. The problem. Oh no, no, I'm not ready for this. Cleaning up garbage is one thing, but this is completely another thing, and I don't even know what exactly. I search Cyrus's eyes for something to comfort my spirits, but I find nothing and do not know why I bothered at all. His face is indiscernible as ever, aside from the serious brow and lip, of course. The message will begin in 10 seconds. Crap. The message will now play. The crest vanishes, revealing a man in a suit at a desk, a dapper brown suit and a large brown desk. I imagine he must be important, as the crest from before is quite brazenly carved into the wood of his furniture. As for the man himself, he looks older than Cyrus, which is ancient at worst and age 60 at least. He looks very tired. His face is worn, and his expression does nothing for the mood. He does have some fake-looking hair, though. That's pretty funny. I almost have a small chuckle, but given the severe expressions of my company, I decide it would be best to stifle it. Brighton? Brighton. We have endured. As a people, as a country, as a workforce, we have endured these past 120 years. Surely, surely, you are all very, very tired. I, my people, my friends am very, very tired. The words sobering meant little to me before this, but I completely understand it at this moment. The way this man carries himself, his speech, and his dour voice have all combined to chill the warmth from my head. I set my stool back down and have an actual seat, looking up at the monitor with certain intensity. The man has me engaged. I'm tired of the media portraying our common man, the fool, an ignorant sort, all too glad to do the deeds of his betters. Tired of these foreign companies providing us work and wages that we will celebrate for only pennies more. Tired of hearing my people say in passing and in normalcy, "No, I do not know if we will eat today. Perhaps tomorrow." Brighton, I am tired of our masters. I'm so, so tired. People of Brighton, we have grown so used to freedom we've forgotten that we're not free. This chair and this desk, this stage of an office on which I play my part, is evidence of that. I offer a serious and composed look to Cyrus. If I'm understanding correctly, and I can't say I'm one for understanding much of anything on this world, it seems like this leader here is not as much of a leader as he might like. Which frankly I don't quite get. The way leadership works back home, at least on the large scale, is that several especially intelligent and reasonable people rule over all of us. The idea of power not of power being not enough, or being feigned, seems complicated to me. Like, what's the point? Why the show? I'd like to ask Cyrus about it, but he isn't returning my gaze, and instead remains focused on the television. I suppose I'll just have to keep listening. But I am not here to tell you the troubles of our state. I am not here to tell you the glory of our fathers. I am here to confirm the quiet whispers through the alleys and the worried murmurs of Gabrian elite. Pardon? Consider this a threat. People of Gabria, you have 4 hours to comply with my demands or a nuclear weapon will be launched at your country. Holy shit! That can't be good. Yeah! Wow! Winter, come over here for a minute. I rise and step over my mentor, feeling surprisingly clear-headed and befuddled all at once. He takes me from the counter, leaving the three gentlemen to discuss whatever it is exactly that the man on the television just brought up. A nuclear weapon? The hell is that? What does Barnaby think he's doing? Can't believe he really did it. What kind of place does he think this is? Sir, could you please break down what just happened? I'm kind of lost here. Winter. I know we've only just arrived, but did you look at the files you were given at all? I did. Have you been paying any attention to anything out here? I have. You have. Then explain who that man is. Explain anything. Don't put me on the spot like that. The leader of Brighton, sir. President Barnaby. He's angry about Gabria. I'm not an idiot. Gracious, why can't I articulate or explain it any better? I just wanted to clarify some things because I'm shadowing you. Sorry. I reacted out of impulse. I forget how unprepared life in our world could leave us for these things. His tone shook me up quite a bit. I'm shivering a little. I was going to lie and say I understand, but I'm having a lot of trouble speaking right now. I want to go home. Winter, you may not have realized the severity of this situation. This isn't going to be community service like your first assignment. I know that. Hey, eyes straight, Harrison. Allow me to be frank. Brace yourself, because there may be a lot of dying happening soon. Dying? But... I'm shocked. Honestly, I figured those rumors I heard from Clark were only that. Hold on. Hold it. Death? I just thought... As far as we knew, this world hadn't even developed nuclear weapons yet. What did I think? He said weapon. Am I daft? Though with their strides in utilizing nuclear fusion for electricity, I suppose it was only a matter of time. People are going to die? It's people dying. Just slow it down for a second. I suppose that's what comes with our job. Not everything can be in the dossiers, right? We smooth out the creases and bring chaos to order. Slow it down. Calm down. And with that, I will be right back. Okay, I am back. Slow it down. Calm down. Though sudden wars really are rare. War? My mind starts to tumble, and my heart tries to explode from my chest. I definitely can't handle this. War isn't something I'm supposed to take care of. Shut up, don't excite the locals. I cover my mouth and raise my shoulders. Of course they're looking for a war. You can't believe people dying is just a commonality. Do you even think properly? I'm finding it incredibly hard to do anything properly right now. Shaking, I turn to see people at the counter. They thankfully are still engrossed in the president's speech. I look back at Cyrus and speak softly through my fingers. Shouldn't I go home?
Yeah.
Oh. This was supposed to be something like diplomacy. Goes to show you how important it is to get a look at the situation yourself. Anyway, if what I heard was right, we don't have the time to get you out of here without causing a scene. As you should know, interplanar... I think it's pronounced planar. Interplanar shifts take longer to prepare than just moving from place to place. But I'll protect you no matter what happens, Winter. And you know how to escape if you really must. Yes. I don't know if I want to do that anymore, though. If he is talking about maybe dying. Of course, we don't have a lot of time in general. His demands I couldn't care less about. But this deadline? 4 hours. Consider this a powerful lesson and come with me. We proceed to exit the bar without saying goodbye. It seems it is time to get to work. It is too bad that I'm terrified. We take to the streets at a quick pace, Cyrus leading to wherever. I find it difficult to keep up with him, though, and in more ways than one, my head is still swimming from the mention of war. What level is the war, do you think? You mean, what level do I think it'll be? It hasn't happened. With any luck, it won't. Luck? I'm thinking this could be something like a 4 on the scale. 4? 4. Ah. Oh gracious, 4 is 1 away from 5 and 2 from 6, which is terrible. 6 is very, very terrible. The worst. Even 4, though. A war without rules. That must be particularly gross. It is a very disturbing prospect. So disturbing that I grab my hair and almost shut my eyes. What exactly is this? What will happen? Test. What do you think? Is it really the time for tests? Be appreciative that I'm even doing this work, Winter. He seems so much more angry than before. How irksome. What do I think? What it could be? Well, first of all, Gabrielle will respond to Brighton's threat. Possibly. Possibly? Why wouldn't they? I'll answer that for you, because it might work in their favor to ignore it. I don't get it. Just think, Winter. Oh, okay. Just think. Wonderful advice, you... Well, maybe they just don't care at all about Brighton, and they'll use this tantrum as an excuse to destroy them. That's... nonsensical, I know. Keep pointing out how I'm like a fish attempting to walk. That's right, Winter. You're right about why they wouldn't respond. What? How... absurd. Isn't Gabria a leech on Brighton's back? They need Brighton, so why would they want to destroy it? Well, they wouldn't actually destroy Brighton. What they would do is invade and take away the little freedom and independence this country still clings to. Then they would be able to take advantage of the citizens in ways unprecedented. What a disgusting thought. I can barely even imagine it. Alright, now here's another question. Why does Brighton think it can take on Gabria? Damn it, Cyrus. How should I know? The same way you knew the first answer. I was bullshitting. Language. Sorry, sir. Thinking about recent events might help. Goodness, is he trying to get me to think in the place of murderers? Those are boots I would not like to fill. I guess that I have to, though. He mentioned recent events. I can't think that a minimum wage increase would embolden his country... this country enough to believe they could stand against an obviously superior nation. Especially with how unimpressed the president seemed to be about it. Even David wasn't terribly excited. Oh, David! What was it that David mentioned? Their new army. The person I spoke with, his name was David. He said that Brighton had gotten a military recently to defend itself against the border country, Fedria. He said it was because Fedria is dangerous and ignores treaties. But isn't it far more likely that this army was actually created to engage with Gabria? With an actual military and what seems to be a new kind of weapon, at least judging from how the locals reacted. Then, that would explain their confidence. I think. See, Winter? You are cut out for this. Wait. Don't reference things I mumbled to myself before we came here. Creep. Then you understand the situation? Yes, but I'm curious. Isn't this more like a level 5 war? As Brighton and Gabria are technically separate, I can't call what might happen a civil war. Then it's a technicality? Just a technicality? I figured Brighton and Gabria were still very close. Well, look at you. You're all calm. I frown with indignation. I am not at all calm if this is essentially a level 5 war. Well, you look it. I do not let up with my frown. Whoops. Well, that isn't all there is. How this might proceed largely has to do with what level I would give this potential war. Cyrus stops, and I stop in turn. We are now in front of a fountain. It took me the entire time till now to realize that the city streets are deserted. The doorways are even clear of those ragged children who'd ask us for pennies. Could it be that everyone is listening to the address? Before I can drift off on this thought, Cyrus looks down at me. A nuclear weapon is one that can kill a lot of people and destroy a lot of things almost instantly. Excuse me? Honestly, Winter, what did you think I'd meant earlier when I said a lot of dying could be expected? I won't go into the details, but it's not something you would have been taught about yet. I've dealt with it before, though. You're lucky. I'm not lucky at all. Not even in the littlest slightest. What kind of thing is that? Is it magic? This isn't a magical world, Winter. Thank the higher-ups, you won't be going to those just yet. They're less fun than they sound. I should not be going to worlds with wars either. Point. You can check your codex for information about what we'll be dealing with, if you'd like. I need to contact support and update them anyway, so at the least it will give you something to do while you wait. What is it called exactly? Just nuclear weapon seems rather broad, like spear weapon or fruit drink. I believe that it's a fusion bomb. While Barnaby didn't specify, the rumor I heard supports it. Also, it makes sense, considering the reactors. Reactors? You forgot? We saw them when we first arrived. This country utilizes fusion reactors for power. Ah, right. The looming and shadowy giants that stand on the distant steps. I remember not wanting to remember them. They were disconcerting. Like many other things here, they looked a mess. And unlike many other things here, they vibrated. I thought they were going to violently break apart. Anyway, fusion bomb should be under weapons, obviously. It's technically not pure fusion, but most worlds can only do so much. Not pure? Well, it's a limited reaction jump started by fission. True fusion bombs are rather like man-made stars. Stars are beautiful. Not the word I'd use for those. Just keep the distinction in mind and read that fusion bomb entry. Right. Understood. I mumble this as Cyrus turns from me and begins raising his wrist to his mouth. He suddenly pauses, though, and addresses me again. Oh, and Winter. While you're at it, check out the appropriate entries pertaining to this world. Always mind your codex. It could save lives. Remember to keep tabs on it. Understood, sir. I look at my own wrist. Both of us are sporting bracelets which look very similar to stylish and thin digital watches. We have to regularly hide them from view as we are advised that they are considered suspicious looking, usually. Hey, it's Cyrus. You guys probably noticed there's trouble at this world. Yes, more trouble. Cut the cutesy crap. This isn't the time. I'm actually... Oh? He's actually what exactly? I look at him. He notices that I'm listening, shifts a little, and walks out of my range of hearing. That is worrisome. I look back at my wrist device. My LCD. Wait, is it? No, that's an eye. ICD. Interplanar communication device. A name which does not actually cover all that it does. It also carries the database and tells time and probably a thousand other things, as it is fancy. Honestly, if there's anything magical I have encountered so far as a student mediator, it is most definitely the ICD. Science magic or some such. It basically does everything. It is how we get to other worlds and teleport around them. And it can open up a tiny pocket dimension for holding things. An inventory, it's called. I think it is pretty cool. Seriously? It can open up a tiny pocket dimension that makes the inventory? They're actually trying to justify the inventory in the game? It's cute. That's cute, but... I don't know. And it came from my own world. I would never have imagined. Right now, I need to access the codex. I focus this thought, open the codex, and the device recognizes the command, as it is linked with my mind, which is awesome. A tiny holographic screen emits from the device in a rather inconspicuous fashion, yet still in an acceptably readable size. I begin to navigate the database, searching for, well, let's see. Suli, Brighton, Gabria, and Fedria too, I suppose. I think I'll leave Fusion Bomb for last. Okay. Welp, I'm going to read these, but I've been playing for quite a while, and I want to save my voice from being completely wrecked. Can I save? Oh god. I think it might think that I already read it. Certainly this is amazing. I smile pleasantly in admiration of the technology. I'm guessing it's going to just continue with the story, but I think I can just go back to it any time, right? Yeah, okay. Yeah, no big deal. I just want to advance this. So let me save it. There we go. It's pretty cool. You can actually use the right mouse button to open up the menu. Very neat. Okay, yeah, I'm going to end this episode here. So far, I really like it. It's... Well, as I said when I first started, the art is incredible, and it still is. It's amazing art. Wonderful, wonderful art. It's so good. The music is great. It's set in a really... I was going to say an interesting world, but it's not a world, actually. It's set in a bunch of interesting worlds, you know. The game universe, so to speak, is very intriguing. Two things of note that I find interesting, and that is, at the moment... Even though I don't believe this is a kinetic novel. No, it said there's supposed to be multiple endings to the game. Either to the game or to the episode, I'm not sure which. But it's not a kinetic novel, which means there should be... You should have the ability to influence the story, but at the moment, I haven't had any control over anything that happens at all. But it's probably going to open up, I'm assuming. I'm assuming at some point I'm going to be presented with options. Because given that he wants me to read the codex, I get the feeling that I'm going to need to make some decisions pretty soon. So I think everything I just played was kind of the introduction. That's what I'm thinking. And the other thing is that... I want to know more about the backstory. Like, does this go into the backstory? No, I mean, this talks about the backstory of the world that we're on right now, but I want to know more about, like, where she came from, and her world that she's talking about, where apparently poverty is not even an issue. And where there's... What are they called? Mediators? These people? That manage chaos? Like, you go to school to be taught to manage chaos, and you go to different worlds? Like, what? I mean, that's... That's freaking crazy. And yet, I know absolutely nothing about it. I don't know anything about... where the hell she's come from. Or what this thing is that she's doing, a mediator. what being a mediator actually is. You know, it's a crazy idea, and I'm intrigued, but at the moment I just don't know anything about it. And the fact that I'm like an hour and a half into the game and I don't know anything about it did make it a little bit hard for me to get into in the very beginning, because I didn't know what was going on and I didn't know these characters all that much. And I still don't really. So I feel like the pacing might be a little... Maybe not the pacing. I guess just like the character development might be a little bit too light in the beginning. Like, I want to know... I need some context on where the hell they came from. And I think that's prevented me from getting into this as much as I'd like, but I'm starting to get into it more. I really like it, don't get me wrong. It's just that I feel like at this point in the game, I should already know a little bit more about what the hell is going on. Not just in this world. I mean, obviously she's new to the world, so you're expected to not know anything about this world, but I just mean in the larger sense, her character and whatever world she came from and whatever school she is in that is doing this, like what? Tell me more about it. I really want to know. So yeah, that's my only real problem with the game, is that the sort of the character development or story development at this stage in the game is a little bit slow, but I'm very intrigued and I'm really impressed, and it's damn good so far. So I hope you have enjoyed so far, and I will be back soon.